audience, welcome back to the second portion, second hour of our show on nanoethics, social implications, and legal aspects. And in this hour, I have Dr. Patrick M. Bowser, who is author, attorney, and also a scientist. He's with the law firm of Marsh Fresh Filshman, and DeVogel, IP Law in Denver, Colorado. And he has graciously accepted being on the show, and I appreciate that, Dr. Bowser. And at the same time, he and I share one thing at least in common. We have the same publisher, and he wrote a beautiful book, and I strongly advise it, as I do with the nanoethics books of Dr. Moore and his colleagues, but with Dr. Bowser, Nanotechnology and its Legal Aspects. And not only you, audience, but any attorney that's practicing out there and listening to our show that has not kept up with the nanotechnology, you need to read this book because it's a whole new world in intellectual property and guarding that technology and at the same time addressing it in the field. Dr. Bowser, thank you for coming on to the show.
Thank you very much for having me.
Oh, I appreciate it. And I know that it took time to write your book, but I love your book. It's not only got diagrams, but it's like a scientist putting it together, which you are, and the pictures in it are wonderful. And my favorite little diagram in the book is the one on Anubis, because I love to study ancient mythology, and where it uses the different shapes and everything, as you call it, nano-sized sculpture and graphic art that way in the text. But for our audience, can you give like a little overview of how nanotechnology as compared to other types of technology or chemical patents or anything is a little different than regular, I mean it's the patents and the trademarks and everything are the same, but because of trying to identify it in the field or the end product, it may be harder. Could you share with our audience?
Yeah, there are a number of issues, actually, that nanotechnology presents from a legal perspective that are different than other kinds of technologies. When it comes to protecting ideas involving nanotechnology through patents primarily, one of the main issues is that there is a concept in patent law that you're not entitled to get a patent if you're doing just a change in scale of something. So that if you're doing the same thing that people have done before but are just doing it with smaller things, then you wouldn't be entitled to get a patent on that. And so one of the issues that many inventors are confronted with is trying to identify what is actually new and different about what they're doing rather than just a change of scale in this way.
Yeah, that would be a very important part, just as we shared in the early portion of the show. Even just the aspects of, when you use the term mesogens, which I know that they can be as high as eight layers thick of different nanomaterials.
Right.
Say the first one was acetylcholinesterase chloride nanotubes, whoever made those, versus the silica nanotubes versus say a sol gel with some other metal in it, or you know, meaning like nanowires or anything. What I'm saying is, I mentioned four different types of nano materials. Each could be individually patentable, or at the same time, collectively as a whole. When does this, as you said, the size or the materials change, so that it is patentable?
Right, and there is no clear dividing line when it comes to the size. And so what people have to look at, what patent examiners look at when they're looking at applications from inventors, is what is new sort of conceptually, what new kinds of problems did they need to solve in trying to create these devices that are very small. An issue that you raise about different pieces coming from potentially different sources is relevant not only to the patentability aspects, but also to the liability aspects. If there is a case sometime when someone becomes injured or sick because of some nanotechnology product, there can be a real difficulty in tracing the causation to the particular component that caused the illness or the harm. And that's one of the major challenges that confronts people trying to address the issues involved with litigation involving nanotechnology.
Right. And for an example, audience, what Dr. Bauscher is saying is, if you have, say you made a nano belt, that's just the term, but it was made out of vinyl chloride, and you're the only manufacturer, then it would be easy to identify that liability. Of you might not have made it in the application it's done, but someone bought it from you and made some other nano machine or device out of it and used it, versus when you have so many different components, it's hard to identify, unless possibly if it's one is what is the components, but also the technology. I'll give you an example, Dr. Bauscher. If say that nanomaterial was done as a patent, but then it could be integrated into a certain reacting with a certain frequency as similar to like we have a fax machine where you can send a certain signal through and you get a beautiful image no matter where you are in the world on whatever you're faxing to that person. If something like that, then you could possibly trace it from other areas.
I think that's exactly right.
Yeah. But it's a lot of work, too, you know, in trying to identify it, let alone trying to keep the patent straight.
It is a lot of work, and another factor that kind of plays into this also is that scientists are not entirely certain about how many of these particles affect the human body, and there's still a lot of research to be done on that. And so when somebody does suffer an injury, it is very often difficult to trace it back and point to it being due to some sort of nanotechnology product or some other environmental product that might have been in that person's life.
Right, and that's a very good point, because you even addressed a concept of that in your text in reference to where you brought out that there. Say we have these engineers that developed the technology, and there was an article that showed the hazards of the nanotechnology, but they didn't read it. The question is, who's liable if they were the manufacturers and the knowledge was out there, versus if there was no papers out there of the hazards, then there's no one addressing those hazards. And I think with a lot of this nanotechnology or the smaller the molecule getting into the cell, just as we know the benefits with gene delivery or even the nano delivery systems that are out there, it has benefit. But at the same time, I don't think anyone was looking at or even had the knowledge to know that maybe the body would accumulate it because the body's basic gene is survival. So if we can't use it, we're going to accumulate it.
Right. And there are many other examples not involving nanotechnology where those undiscovered effects have not been manifest for years and years down the line as people begin to learn what the actual effect is, especially, as you point out, when there is some sort of accumulation of a substance within the human body.
Right. And as I brought out on the other half of the show, when you take these, I'm going to call it the nanotechnology, and apply it into vaccines that you can put into the cells of plants or that, meaning that's a whole other field. Meaning just in this show alone, there's so many aspects of patentable material, trademark identification, service mark from the types of terms used or any of this. And in some cases, like we touched on it with my last guest, with Dr. Moore, how do you identify? You're an intellectual property attorney. You're advising your clients of how to guard their property, which is their creativeness, and you guard it into the disciplines of either trademark, copyright, patent, or other areas, and even the licensing, even if you keep it proprietary. The thing is, how would you be able, since it's used in such either small quantities or large quantities or however it is, how would they, even if they, I'm going to use an example like licensed it, how would they keep up with the numbers or the use of it? It's a little bit different than how many books the publisher produced to publish the book. Or would you go by the units or anything? Because I've personally had a hard time, you know, like in the identification. What is the service mark? What is the trademark? Where do you see it on it? Like we touched in reference to the use of quantum dots, like you did in your book with the Anubis.
Right. In the area of nanotechnology, the most important intellectual property protection are the patent protections rather than the trademark or copyright protections, which are much weaker. And I think you've correctly identified one of the problems with the trademark and copyright protections is that we're talking about particles on such a small scale that it can be difficult to identify when there's some kind of infringement. And that can be true also with the patent claims, that when somebody has invented something, a new nanoactuator, for example, or some other new nanostructure, even MEMS, which are a little bit larger than nanostructures, but NEMS, then it can be one of the challenges when working with a patent attorney is to try to figure out how to describe the invention in a way that it can be identified when it's actually being used. And so sometimes we don't necessarily focus on the machine itself, the nano device itself, but we focus on the way in which it's manufactured or the way that it is distributed through chains of commerce. And those are the things that are somewhat easier to identify, and so it's more of a strategic kind of way of trying to figure out exactly how we're going to identify potential infringers.
Right. And with, like you said, in reference to how it's made, or I'm going to call it developed, that would be part of the patent side that is not actually like a working machine. It's a method. It's like the recipe of how to make it, you know, for our audience. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's exactly right. So something, for example, that's been on the marketplace for a long time are sunscreens that have nanoparticles in them that are reflective and they protect the skin from the ultraviolet radiation from the sun when you wear the sunscreen. And so while there could be patents that are directed to the sunscreen itself, it's sometimes easier to identify factories and commercial centers that are involved with producing the sunscreen, and those might be the kinds of things that we might target instead.
Right, right, because like in the example of sunscreens, there's a limited group of sunscreen makers, you know, or developers
right.
in the area. And so that allows one to be more focused in that way and then bring out, as you brought out on the second half of protecting the patents, would be the commerce of how that development has changed hands. And that brings an important point out because one is a lot of this nanomaterial was developed in universities and now sometimes funded by private industry or I'm going to say government or military in developing the need of what that research was to be. But how does or how, from your side as a patent attorney, say you were representing a private industry that hired a university to make it, who owns the rights to it, or who owns the patent under that the managing of the university intellectual property? Because a lot of universities, audience, they now create to manage this intellectual property what they call university foundations, which is like a spin-off of the university.
Yeah, this actually has a fascinating history to it, and I'm not sure I actually talked about this all that much in the book, but before 1980, the basic thinking was that work that's done in universities by researchers is largely funded by the federal government and other government agencies. And so why should the researcher have a property interest in his invention when he's being paid by public funds? And wouldn't it make more sense for those developments just to be publicly available so that there is no increase in the charge for using those products because the public has already paid for them? But what was found was that most of those ideas never got commercialized because there was no financial incentive to do so. And so in 1980, Congress passed the Bayh-Dole Act, and that act allows universities to have an ownership interest in the inventions developed by the researchers that they employ, even though they are funded by the federal government. And so there is now this this structure where developments take place in universities, and they work to spin off the technology into small corporations or even sometimes into larger corporations so that those developments can be commercialized and then sold to the public. And the result actually has been fairly dramatic in the last 30 years, that many of those basic research kind of technologies that have been developed are actually being commercialized much more successfully now than they were in the past.
Right, and many of the universities that have done that, they create, especially in the nano field, what they term incubators, and incubate that business, let it nurture, take it through, I'm going to call it like a master's program of business, so that the goal is that the business is successful because they're jointly on that technology, so that they can share the success of that technology in, I'm going to call it licensing fees, or however it's divided. But like with that researcher, years ago when I worked in industry and in aerospace and that, we always had to sign a conflict of interest form for whatever we were working on that was separate from what our employment was. At the same time, whatever during that employer range of aerospace, whatever was created during that time, they owned, meaning when you created it at the office, you know, in that industry. With the researchers, like the professors or anything, do they own or do they get a royalty? Because it used to be that they didn't.
No, not usually. Usually what happens is that the professor will develop some invention and discover that, you know, this is actually something that is commercially useful. And the university will own it. But the university only owns what he's developed up to that point. And so the usual pattern that happens is that the professor then goes on and starts up a small company to further develop the research. And while the university might own that basic core technology and license it to the professor's company, the professor then goes on with his collaborators to develop other things, not being funded by the university, but being funded by private investors, and then can commercialize that, and his company then owns those future developments, which oftentimes are much, much more valuable, much more commercial than the very basic research that often takes place in universities.
Right, and when it goes to, I'm going to say, the collaborative research and also finding the private investor, then the approach with the individual professor or who would be in that incubator situation with the university, it would be more like a joint venture with that little company and the university then, wouldn't it?
Yep, that's exactly right. And so I think sometimes that's where those conflict of interest issues arise, is because the professor is being funded by a federal grant. Is the work that he's doing for the really work that he's doing for the university that is going to be owned by the university, or is he using that money to develop something commercial that is really separate from that? And so sorting out those potential conflicts of interest can be very important in determining the ownership of some of those inventions.
Right, and especially, too, not necessarily if you're a professor or the researcher there, but if you're a small company and creative and you go to the university and have contract with them, that in a lot of times, meaning you're in that incubator situation or they encourage you to go into that situation, but that university may not necessarily sign your conflict of interest forms or anything, and thus that would put you more at open for loss of your intellectual property, I would think.
It can very often happen. Universities have discovered in the last quarter century that there is potential big business in some of the discoveries that their professors make during the course of their research.
Mm-hmm. And it's all going. You yourself are writing this beautiful book on the nanotechnology and its legal aspects. Even though it's a nice reading book, you've condensed it. You haven't nanotized it, but it's condensed. I had it. Throw in that little joke. It's condensed so that it flows. At the same time, what I like about this audience is that Dr. Boucher has put, which is so hard, you're a true scientist at heart, you put the words with the picture so that you can see it in your mind as you read it and go back and use that picture as a reference. And it's very, very well done that way.
Oh, thank
and
you.
You're welcome.
It was actually a fun book to write. It came about because a friend of mine, Louis Horniak, had this idea of writing this series of books on social aspects of nanotechnology. And there were a group of us who wrote different books on different aspects. Somebody else wrote a book on environmental aspects, and someone wrote on business aspects and that kind of thing. And I wrote about the legal aspects. And this was a little bit of a deviation for CRC, which tends to publish books that are written in a much more technical style than these particular books are written in.
Correct.
It tended to be a little bit informal.
Correct, because they've been hardcore since all of us have had the not chem abstracts, but you know that I can't think of it right now. The chemical and physics handbook, you know, the big
right.
thing we've all had
right.
to have it. If you ever took a organic class in your life, audience, you had to have that book or have reference to access to it at the reference library. I think that publisher is over 100 years old now, and they've bought a lot of the other companies that were in the publishing of specific sciences and stuff, textbooks and other materials. So I'm glad that they're making the change and bringing out this knowledge, because it's so important, not just in what's happening to guard, for your clients and even people that are listening to this show that are very creative and may have very ideas to interact with, your law firm and hopefully getting some aspects of patents or trademarks or anything. But just looking at on one of your pages, specifically on 132, on the other side, nanotechnology audience is not only just with chemicals, it's with microorganisms, toxins, material processing, electronics, computers, telecommunications, like with the smart motes, laser sensors, navigational, marine, propulsion systems. That whole field is many different sciences, many different disciplines, and it's in every aspect, and so it's time for our audience and ourselves to be aware. You're aware of it, and you do this as a daily business. We've even had, where research is done where they've taken quantum dots and put them into water fleas to do different tests and see how that is done. And that was funded under EPA research grants, et cetera. But I often wonder, what happened to those water fleas that had the quantum dots?
Right.
Even though the experiment was a success, but did they leave it in the lake? How do you clean it up? Do we need
right.
to clean it up, et cetera? What happens to the fish that eats the little water flea? Do they glow too? I don't know.
Actually, I found that discussion that you were having with Dr. Moore about the impact on aquatic life an interesting one, because one of the challenges with regulating nanotechnology has been exactly what you point out, is that it is so pervasive in the different kinds of areas in which it might be implemented, so that certainly in the United States and until very recently also in Europe, there has been no regulatory framework that is directed specifically at nanotechnology. The attempts to regulate it have used already existing frameworks for, you know, products that have been developed in the past. And the EPA, when it was examining certain, I think it was sunscreens that it was examining, but I'm not 100% sure that it was sunscreens. In any case, it performed its studies and it looked at the impact on human beings of using sunscreens and decided that they were safe under certain parameters, but they didn't go on to look at what the impact might be when the sunscreen gets washed off into lakes and oceans and what kind of impact it might have on marine life. And that's a consequence of the regulatory framework being segmented with technology that is really very continuous and pervasive.
Correct, and I appreciate that, because look in the last 20 years in just environmental discharges. We have manufacturing plants that use specific chemicals that could be making rugs or, you know, materials, which I'm saying synthetic fibers, et cetera, this way, and those chemicals can get into the water sources, because with any type of manufacturing facility, the drinking water and also your groundwater monitoring wells are monitored, and hopefully you can monitor it correctly, because sometimes the plume of the water underground or the flow may be 6 inches off from that area where you're testing, and you might even miss it. But the thing is, we can recognize, I want to call it regular chemicals, hazardous materials and that, but when you take hazardous materials and then now enhance it with nano aspects, how do you monitor that? It's very hard, because they're currently developing sensors and stuff like that, but at the same time, we don't know the consequence of. We don't know what's going to happen.
It is something that is very hard. And there was a point I made in the book, actually, in which I have a lot of sympathy for the perspective of scientists, having developed myself as a scientist. But scientists sometimes get an excitement over their technologies, and they're fascinated by the technological aspects of it, and they don't always think through some of the ramifications down the road. And it is really the responsibility of governments, through legal mechanisms, to monitor what those later ramifications are. And this kind of tension can sometimes be a source of conflict for scientists in particular, who want to pursue the technological aspects, and who sometimes are not fully considerate of the apprehensions that the public might have about certain technologies.
Right. I agree with you. I love what you quoted in here, giving the hypothetical physician is not omniscient. You know, he can't see it all sometimes.
Right.
And I love the other concept of yours, which was the eggshell skull rule of how that doctrine will be done and causations. But the thing is, it's like you pointed out, it's hard. It's new territory. It's beyond pioneering, because this technology has been, meaning microspheres, if we look at that from Germany during World War II and the Nazi realms or any of that, was in 1934. As we looked at Dr. Moore's sizes of augmentation of making tires of 100 years ago was using the graphene balls or the spheres. It's been a long time around. It's just that the creativeness of the science and the engineering has now put it into a new technology, and it's now where people like ourselves are looking at and saying, well, what is this doing to the body? What is this doing to the environment? At the same time, you have a dual role, not only protecting the interest of the intellectual property of your client, whether it's industrial, university, or a private individual, but also through this book, as you just pointed out, you've addressed the concern you have, which is very caring, as a fellow scientist, of okay, you create this material or this creation of nanotechnology, and then it does something harmful, like what we experienced in the late 50s, 60s, you know, with thalidomide. You know, it's like a shock to the whole body, let alone the soul, when the reality of that type of effect occurs. And we don't know the answers right now. When you can take clone DNA splices and make puppies glow in the dark so you don't trip on over them, or make little fleas glow in the dark, and expand in many other areas, no one's thinking about, well, what happened to that? What now? My question is, like, with the puppies that glow in the dark, when they grow up, do they have puppies that glow in the dark too when they have puppies? You know, I don't know. They're still growing, you know. And technology has gone so far. It's amazing how it's going. And I love it, because the movies parallel it, whether they're informing us and preparing our mind, that's one thing, but at the same time, I enjoy them. And it's just growing, you know, in many, many aspects. And could we touch, if you don't mind, we talked about a little bit about liabilities and everything on the different avenues, but you know, there's one is the causation, one is the strict liability, also the criminal liability. Could you just touch on that, of how I don't want to say the definitions of, but how our audience can perceive that by the use of nanotechnology, or I should say in that area, if that was found to be the cause of it.
Right. This is an area that is very much speculative, because I'm not aware of any case, actually, even now, where there has been an issue of liability due to a nanotechnology product in a lawsuit. The lawsuits that have existed have tended to be fights over who owns the intellectual property with respect to certain nanotechnology products, but I think it's inevitable that there will be some case where, you know, there are so many examples. Historically, asbestos is probably
definitely
of something that had, you know, wonderful properties, but at the time, not well foreseen long term consequences.
Correct.
I suspect that there will come a time when there is a lawsuit involving a nanotechnology product, and then there are a variety of different theories, legal theories, that exist to try to assign liability for that. And those rely on traditional theories of products liability, whether or not something has been designed in a way that has not taken careful enough account for the potential safety issues. And if that's the case, if scientists and manufacturers have moved quickly without properly assessing some of those safety concerns, then they could be potentially liable for any harms that their product cause under very traditional kinds of product liability theories.
Right, and even one is product concerns and the liability that way. You could be the manufacturer out there. You're selling it to say a medical group or anything, but then the deviantness maybe of a medical, say the deviant physician, I'm going to use that, uses this for a whole other area that was not part of his research or part of the other, and it can go into, I'm going to call it the realms of criminal, where say they were using it for injections or something, and it was supposed to be used under this one research activity, but then the physician got creative and used it on another aspect, it not only puts them at the individual liability, but also whatever they're connected to in work, the physician, or the company, once they see that it's not, they can prove that there was some kind of criminal intent, would that separate the company who is the manufacturer of the original technology? In particular, like nano?
It's not an easy question. The original manufacturer would probably be insulated from the criminal liability because in order to commit a crime, the law requires that you have some kind of mental state that intends to do some harm to somebody else. And so the individual who misused the technology in order to cause that harm might certainly be liable for some sort of crime. What the original manufacturer might be liable for is a failure to foresee that misuse. And so there could well be civil liability in that kind of circumstance where not exercising that due caution to prevent the technology from being misused in that way would give rise to civil liability.
Mm. Very interesting point, especially taking that whole concept and say, which they just made the press releases, and we touched on this first half of the show, you know, where they can take a implantable chip, a nanochip, and put it in the brain and transfer the thoughts. If those thoughts were transferred to go and commit a crime, it's going to be quite interesting, you know, who the where the liability would be.
Right. You know, very traditional kinds of examples are things like firearms. To what extent are the manufacturers of firearms liable when those are used in crimes? And there sometimes can be civil liability in those cases, even if there isn't criminal liability for the actual commission of the crime, which is limited to the person who uses it in an improper way. But there still can be civil liability if appropriate precautions are not taken.
Yeah, and the thing is, I know how difficult it is explaining, and I know you're in the field of representing nanotechnology, you know, from the intellectual property side of it as a patent attorney and guardian of those properties. If you're not in your little inner circle, it's hard to explain it, so I could see not only the difficulties in presenting a case, but at the same time, having the jury understand, if it's a you know a trial jury, this technology, because they probably never had it in school.
Right. That's why I think these kinds of discussions can be very important and valuable.
I appreciate that.
Yes, some people sometimes get a misunderstanding of some kind of technology and don't have a good assessment of the, you know, of the real risks and the real benefits of the technology and the law. Yet the law wants to take these technologies and come up with a well-reasoned and structured way to use them for their benefits. And this kind of dialogue where people are educated just allows legislators and lawmakers more generally to make better informed decisions when they understand realistically what the benefits of the products are and what the potential risks of the products are.
Mm-hmm. And you brought it even out on your book. You gave a beautiful example where I could see a case could come, you know, where you brought out the aspect of, you know, how trousers or clothing can be treated with nanoscale stain-resistant clothing or antimicrobial agents or any of this type of activity. But you could go to the cleaners, meaning dry cleaners, take your trousers to get cleaned, they could treat it, and you don't even know it, and then have some reaction, and then you have to trace back of what it is, and then even how to identify it or even test it in your body, if
yep.
it's available to.
Yep, that's a very good example. And it highlights another interesting aspect about regulation, particularly in the United States. The different regulatory agencies have examined many of these technologies and found them to be safe and have therefore made the determination that there's no need to label products as being nanotechnology products. I think recently there have been some developments in Europe suggesting that they will require labeling of nanotechnology products, very similarly to the way in which the United States doesn't require identification of food that comes from genetically modified organisms, but
right.
Europe does. And the issue there is whether or not the consumer should know whether or not the products he's using, you know, whether they're toys coated with antimicrobial nanotechnology structures or trousers with stain-resistant coatings or that kind of thing, for consumers to know whether or not those are in the products that they are using.
Right, because I could see easily, you know, from my experience in toxicology and evaluating cases, and that you know, if you had that person that went to the dry cleaner and their trousers got coated with an anti-stain resistant, like a base of silane, siloxane, but they were a plumber, the individual, and they were already sensitized to, you know, like those silicone, what do you call it, you know, grouts, you know, or caulking, you know, that they use in the bathrooms and stuff as a plumber, and then get that on and then wonder why you're having a reaction when you haven't been around that because you're allergic to it because you settled in the past in a worker comp case. I could see how this could get very complicated in trying to identify it. And even like you brought up, which I came from OSHA years ago, that, you know, asbestos was all over. It was a great fire retardant, had many, many benefits, et cetera. And then we went into the Kevlars because we had to clean up buildings and everything with the asbestos. And all of the people that cleaned up, even though they wore respirators, are having asbestos exposures or anything because sometimes the fibers got through the mask or they didn't use them or whatever. But the thing is, now we have a society in the medicine aspect of nano where they do use brown chrysotile asbestos. They grind it up smaller under the nano size, so it's not in the definition of being quote-unquote regular asbestos, that then it becomes synthetic asbestos, put like a quantum dot, so you get better enhancement of your tumor picture, so you can see it better, you know, in their diagnosis. But this is where asbestos is now a medicine.
Right.
Even though it's a smaller quantity, doesn't meet the regulation from an OSHA standard of permissible, you know, fiber amount within that breathing zone. But I see problems because I know from my experience of how asbestos, when you have asbestos with contaminants of polio vaccine, like with the simian virus that happened in the late 50s with the different strains of the vaccine, if they had that polio and then they were exposed to this, they definitely would get mesothelioma. It's been shown in the literature 100% mesothelioma from that two combination versus just getting it from an initial exposure.
Right.
So what I'm saying is I'm concurring with you, Dr. Boscher, that it's going to be very complex. It's going to take highly skilled experts and fact-finding witnesses to even explain it of how the mechanisms could have occurred, because we're in, I'm going to call it an industrial society now, where my roots were OSHA and also industry, that if I had to, in certain states, if you were exposed to asbestos and from whatever that last employer was, you're entitled to the benefits if you have been diagnosed with asbestosis. But the thing is, what if it was from the dye that you got from the hospital versus you never got it from the other asbestos? If it absorbed in. I don't know the answer, but it just looking at liability, it's multifaceted right now.
Right. I don't know the answer either, but it is a significant issue that arises with all kinds of nanotechnology products. They tend to be, if you recall, when people were modifying corn and other organisms, there was this initial expectation that it would be possible to very much constrain where those genes would end up, and it ended up turning out that the genes managed to propagate to plants that they'd never expected it to. And
right.
I think some of the issues might exist with nanotechnology also, when you're talking about things that are so small that it is difficult to monitor, and when you don't quite fully understand the propagation mechanisms for them, you might end up with nanotechnology appearing in places where you don't expect it.
Right, right. It does. It could easily travel with the wind and the rain in those situations. It really does, or the bugs that touch those flowers or touch those other aspects and travel it, you know, like butterflies or anything.
Right.
But it's a whole new world, and it's going to be a brave new world for all of us. But it's ever growing. You can honestly worry about the results of it. At the same time, you can, like, put your bootstraps up and try to have discussions like we're having now and try to address those concerns so that remedies could be done in the future in these other aspects where the strengths and the weaknesses of, say, the regulations or anything. Because I basically feel that no one wants to do harm to anyone, no matter who they are or the industry or anything. It's just that they may not know right at this particular moment in time the total consequence.
Right. Because the, you know, the benefits of many of these technologies are very remarkable. Even the use of asbestos that you were just mentioning, for example, was not something I was aware of, but the ability to, you know, diagnose potential problems in people by having higher contrast in X-rays is a wonderful advance. And so it's, I think sometimes people get too hesitant about new technologies because of the risks.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, it's important to have an honest and realistic assessment of what those risks are and then try to come up with the right balance.
Right, and that balance could be is if you have that dye that is known to be a health hazard, it might be that you have the antidote of it, if there is one, so that you can take it so that you don't have that body burden within your system. And, you know, with nanotechnology, I'm gonna touch on it because on this aspect, because you brought it out in your book, you touched on it. I'm gonna call it industrial espionage. With the use of nanotechnology, defense, forget any of that. With the way it is, and the person, if they have the right budget, they could literally come into your office, which you are a high-tech office, trying to guard your intellectual property, sprinkle your little office with some crystal moat, and at the same time hear or do or see whatever you're doing in your office, if you were a spy, you know, an industrial spy.
Right. It is fascinating.
And not even detect it. That's what I'm saying. Excuse me
right,
for interrupting
right.
you.
Yeah. No, it is fascinating how creative people can be in using new technologies for nefarious kinds of purposes like that. And moat technology is a perfect example of that, especially when you have, you know, kind of these clouds of networked moats that can gather information from all kinds of places. You can they can be very discreet. And you were talking with Dr. Moore about military applications of,
mm-hmm.
Of nanotech, and I think moats are one aspect that have been identified as having huge potential military aspects.
Oh, definitely.
Because of that information gathering capability.
Oh, definitely. Even here in the Hollywood area, meaning they use the moats and everything to increase the security so that you could track, you know, certain chemicals might be used or dye, so that if you go into the Oscars, you have the surveillance, you know, there. So it's many, many aspects that have been incorporated into different areas and that. And I could see, too, how you could go into a plant and have a little vial or a little something and destroy your competition's whole industry because it got contaminated by something that cut off the oxygen, say, of whatever that source was and caused a lot of damage. It's so easy to do because what's the difference, audience, is usually, like, if you have an open bottle of acetone, like nail polish remover, you can smell it, you can feel it, you can do that. But with this nano, when it's encapsulated or in its appropriate delivery system, usually it's tasteless, smellless. You can't smell it, taste it, or anything. And it's where it can't sometimes be detected unless you have high-tech detectors to sense it.
Right. And at the same time, what I find fascinating is as many negative potential aspects as there are to moat technology like that, there are just as many extremely positive potential uses of it. such as deploying it in environments so that those sensors can detect very small changes and identify how those changes are flowing as very advanced warnings of terrorist attacks on water systems or any other kinds of things like that.
Right. It has its benefits. And also, have you seen, meaning from your, I honestly don't know, and I don't even know if you may know, but you are a patent attorney in nanotechnology and IP. What is the percentage of increase patents in that field compared to regular, I'm going to say, technology patents? Is it growing phenomenally, per year in percentage, maybe 10%, 20%, or is it 300%?
I don't have a good answer to that question off the top of my head. My guess is, the increase in filings at the patent office have been going up for a very long time generally. And my guess is that the rate at which nanotech applications have been filed has been going up even faster than that. It's not something I'm able to quantify.
Right, because I honestly don't know, because the patent office and everything likes to do everything electronic now. You can't even get somebody to answer the phone in a lot of businesses that way. But it's quite interesting of how they're growing, and also international, because could you explain to the audience, once you file a patent here, how do you do the foreign patent of it, or the protection of any type of patent as compared to other countries?
Yeah, for about the last 130 years, actually, there have been efforts to try and harmonize the patent systems in different countries, because at the moment you only have those intellectual property rights in the country where you hold a patent. And as it exists now, when you file a patent application in the United States, you have 1 year, and after 1 year, within that 1 year, you have the opportunity to use that U.S. application to file it in pretty much any other country in the world, certainly all the important industrialized countries. And so it forms a kind of a placeholder in the United States. It might mature into a United States patent, you can also use it as a springboard to get patents in other countries also, as long as you act within that 1 year time period.
Right, and I know that, example, like say you wanted to do, you have your patent here in the United States and you wanted to do Canada, it might be totally different than the patent application here. It might be, what I'm talking about, the fee, meaning $4 maybe, versus you might want to do it in Germany or under those, the European Union, because they block those countries that way. It might be several hundred dollars, that fee, or $1,000. Meaning it can add up when you're looking at other areas and other countries to use this technology.
The fact that patents are still very national forms of intellectual property protection means that those costs can become very large. If you're, just to give some numbers, if you're talking about getting a patent in the United States, you're generally talking about something like $10,000 or $20,000. But if you want to protect that invention, in a reasonable number of countries, you're talking about $500,000, really. And it's a real challenge with the way commerce has become so international in recent years, because it is very easy for a potential infringer to avoid manufacturing in the United States and instead to manufacture in China or Malaysia or some other country. And so one of the challenges that we have in trying to protect people's inventions is trying to address those issues and still do it in a cost-effective way.
Right, and it's hard, especially with all the economical changes that we're all experiencing in the world. I know with any client, ourselves included, we like to try to keep the cost as minimal as possible and also give to that client, as you would do, long-term protection in what they're trying to protect of their intellectual property. Well, my friend, or my new friend, and author of the same publisher, Dr. Boucher, I appreciate you being on the show. I would love to invite both of my guests, back anytime that they would like to discuss any of the technologies or topics of their interest on the show. And for our audience, all of our shows are archived, and you can see them at One Cell, One Light Radio, and also now on YouTube. And thank you very much for being my special guest for this week's show.
Thank you very much. I enjoyed it a lot.
I'm glad you did. I did, too. We could have continual conversation.
Oh, it's a fascinating area, and I guess you have other radio programs to explore more and more things as time goes on.
They will. We're going to do artificial biology and new genes and everything, and ask the world what happened to that 150 million human embryos that were injected with animal DNA a month ago in Europe. Okay.
That is.
Yeah, it's like, where'd you get all those eggs? It must have been from all those hysterectomies. You know,
right?
Where do you get all those eggs?
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Hilde.
You're welcome, dear. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay.
And God
Bye.
Bless to all of you.
Inform, enlighten, alive and amplify. This is the Living Light Network.